You're listening to Vancouver Co-op Radio, CFRO 100.5 FM. We're coming to you from the unceded traditional territories of the Squamish, Musqueam, and Tsleil-Waututh Nations around Vancouver, BC. I'm your host, Bernadine Fox, and this is the show that dares to change how we think about mental health. Welcome to Rethreading Madness. And today we chat with the incredible JD Derbyshire, who is a writer, comedian, mad activist, performer, playwright, theater maker, director, inclusive educator, and innovator. I became aware of them during my work with Kickstart Disability Arts and Culture when I attended their play Certified. We talk about being mad and the need for individuals who live with mental health challenges to have agency in their lives and to consider coming out. And we laughed. We laughed a lot. Stay tuned. I'll be right back with JD Derbyshire.
The Greater Vancouver Food Bank has been providing support for our cities for almost 40 years and has been vital to helping thousands of community members through the COVID-19 crisis. To find out how you might benefit from the Greater Vancouver Food Bank's services, or to learn how you might donate money or volunteer your time, please visit their website at foodbank.bc.ca.
Jan, welcome to the Rethreading Madness show.
Thank you. Great to be here.
Let's throw out all the ways in which we know the world talks about mental health. And as you summed it up so well, when it comes to mad practices, there is a yearning in you to want to talk about it and mental illness differently. So let's talk about it differently. Let's just throw all that out and get into the nitty-gritty of talking about mental health in a way that probably a lot of people have not heard. And so the first thing I want to do is I want to get the semantics out of the way. Do you prefer crazy, mad, loony, psycho, nuts? I mean, I'm just going to go on. Deranged, insane, freak, neurodiverse, sick spaz. What do you use when you're talking about yourself?
When I'm talking about myself, I generally use mad. I just like the mix of the technical ideas of madness, that it comes from the word madness, but also that it's got a more imaginative spirit to it. And that seems to suit me well. So I'm mad. Yes. I think it's a great reclaiming of that word. And, mostly anything else. If I'm talking mad to mad person, I can, anything's fine. If I'm talking to people, you know, I'm always with language like, is this my fight to pick? So, you know, crazy, loony, nuts, sure, on a good day, but mad is the safest thing to meet me with on any
given. Right. I like mad too, but I secretly like it. I guess it's not so much a secret if I say it out loud, because it also implies anger. And for me, anger is usually the thing that motivates me to do change, to make change happen. I get angry. And so to me, anger is a form of madness. And I also agree with the use of mad. We also have a problem in this area. One, I did an anti-racism workshop, and they threw it out to the audience, you know, tell us all the isms, you know, homophobia or this or that. And I said, well, what do you call it when people are oppressed because they're a mental health consumer? And she said, and I also said it for a sexual abuse survivor. And she said it like this. She said, the oppression that mental health consumers face. So it became really clear to me that we're not neatly wrapped up. We don't have a neat little label to describe the ways that we face discrimination or prejudice or other people's assumptions about us that are wrong or inaccurate. And so often when I use the term mental health consumer, I do it because I really don't have another way of describing that. And I don't like it. Lots of people don't like it. And for good reason. We're not buying soap. But when I ask them, what would you prefer I use? They basically look at me blankly.
It's very interesting. I mean, in terms of disability justice, we're starting to hear of ableism. And I think alongside ableism, we're hearing sanism, which I'm really liking, because I think what we really are up against is ideas of what is sane and what is not sane. And at the same time, how each brain is unique, you know, so and emotional life of people is unique. So I don't know, I'm hearing sanism. So at least it opens for me, it opens the conversations of, you know, if we're talking about racism and sexism and homophobia, can we see that these things are also need to be at the table? So
there are ways in which mental health consumers face discrimination all the time. And I came up against it again with an organization that I have been involved in for a long time. And it somehow managed to go from being this sort of mad pride sort of organization into a place where the staff was, again, not educated on these issues. And I remember at one point saying to them, you know, this whole organization works better if you let the collective members, all of whom were mental health consumers, run the show. And the look on the man's face was like, are you've got to be kidding? And it was interesting to me to come up against that again, because I thought we had gotten past it. But there certainly is this idea out there in the world that people who have mental health issues are incompetent, that they're incapable, that they can't make decisions or good decisions anyway, that they're maybe violent or irrational or will kill you, that you can't trust that what they say is real. And of course, that all goes back to Freud and his idea that sexual abuse survivors couldn't discern between truth and fantasy. And so the problem with that I see is that we also live where there's this idea that, you know, it is the mental health professional that is going to fix the mental health consumer. And so for the mental health consumer to get better, there's this idea that they have to accept that they are all these things, that they are incompetent, that they are unpredictable, that they need help and assistance, and they're violent or could be violent or might be violent if they blink. And, you know, that they have to sort of accept all of that and see it somehow and adopt it somehow, that they're sick so that they can fix the thing they don't see, so that maybe they will get better. And you start to see this really demented loop start happening for people who don't even belong there. I did an expressive arts group once through the West Coast Mental Health Network, and we did it in conjunction with the Richmond Mental Health team. And I would go there and I would watch the occupational therapists or social workers who were there in the room supervising their clients while they did art, and watch how people interacted with them. And then at one point they left, and we went and did it with another organization, and some of those same people came and continued on the expressive arts without their occupational therapist in the room. And they acted very differently. They were suddenly much saner. And it's not that they were pretending or anything. They're trying to please people. And so you can sort of see this really sort of insane kind of dynamic get set up, where once a professional, a psychologist or a psychiatrist is in the room, once there's a mental health professional in the room, we are, how would you say it? How would you say
we're
it?
We're observed. I'd say we're observed.
Yes.
You know, one of the problems and interesting things about mental illness is that, I think we're learning more and more about the head is connected to the body, is connected to the spirit. And if those things are separate, that, you know, it's not like you can twist your head off and leave it at the garage and, you know, they can fix that and everything else will be well. So I think that, you know, as I hear you speak, I'm just filled with, compassion for the people who were taking part in that, because one of the, the mental health industry, and it's interesting even to talk about why do we call it mental health? Like, that's just, that's an interesting shift for me, right? I'm not entirely sure it's helpful,
right?
Because what it is an illness, it is an illness. If an illness is, not being able to navigate the world the way other people navigate it, maybe it's not an illness, but the minute it's predicated on the idea that we're never ever going to get well.
Mm.
And so it's set up in a, once you're diagnosed, it's set up as if your diagnosis is a solid state. And so that's where you get to all the things you were talking to previously about. In the worst of my breaks, I did have a lot of rage. I couldn't make decisions. I was not able to differentiate between reality and non-reality. I couldn't function,
mm-hmm.
but that is not a solid state. So if that's the state that's being medicated, and that medication stays the same, then we don't even know when I'm coming out of being able to handle things again, or how that might be. I'm not given any agency. And so once you're in that system, it's very easy to start losing your agency, start believing that the things that they tell you one way or another. Art therapy is, I think a lot about the programs that are funded for people with mental illness. And it's like, as a young artist, I just made, and then I made again, and I made again. I didn't have someone talking to me about what this meant to me, mm-hmm. or, trying to dig out my trauma. Sure, I was probably writing through all kinds of things, but I didn't have to think about it in terms of wellness or normality, or it was just something I did. And I think anything changes the moment it's observed, including us. And unfortunately, diagnosis, there are no tests for mental illness. There are no diagnostics. It's simply observation. So what I hope for is that we just keep talking about this stuff, because how I experience what might get called, complex PTSD or schizophrenia, I've had so many different diagnoses, is my experience. What you have is your experience of anxiety or depression or manic depression, or everyone is, what we need is the agency to be able to be aware of our own minds and to be able to talk about it. And if we're talking to doctors who are, take these pills and that's all you need, that's not true. There's a time and a place for medication. Some people are on medication for their whole life, and that's fine. But we always want to be in conversation about, what is this doing for me? What isn't it doing for me? I work a lot, but I don't work 9 to 5. I probably could never do that and be able to take care of myself. But I do, I am able to follow my own rhythms and feel when I, need breaks, and feel when I'm overwhelmed, and do all kinds of things to take care of myself, which I've been forced to do because I have probably more extreme variations of mood and behaviors and sensitivities that other people do. But the more I spend with people who don't have these things, I feel like the skills we have, which I call mad practices, are needed by everyone. Mm. And we live in a world that is very, very black and white. And
yes,
the difference about being artists with mental illness is that we were already navigating between that black and white, right? That's where artists live generally. Mm-hmm. not so much this or that. And so it's, I think it's easier for us sometimes than for people who are used to, you know, is it this or is it that? I think it's easier for us to move and shape and question and stay curious. But for a lot of people, you know, you get diagnosed with a mental illness. And I know I felt that when I first entered the system, my life is over. That's it. You know, and luckily, I think the curiosity that I seemed to front my life with that, you know, made me an artist, surfaced there too, and was just kind of like, I'm not sure that this is giving me everything I need. So I appreciated what the mental health system was giving me and certainly saved my life at a point. But then I began to see that, you know, maybe there was something in between what my old life might have been and what this life was. And I just started to gather information and talk to other people and luckily was able to figure some things out.
We just need to take a little break, but don't go away, folks. We're going to come right back and talk some more with JD about exactly what she's talking about and just carry it on. So don't go away.
Oh,
listening to Rethreading Madness on Vancouver Called Radio, CFRO 100.5 FM. I'm Bernadine Fox, and I'm sitting down with JD Derbyshire, chatting about madness. JD, you were talking about mad practice. Can you just go into that a little bit more so that we're clear about what you mean?
Sure. I think when I use the term mad practice, I am using a kind of a term that holds things for me that I basically call practices or skills that I use to help me navigate my way through the world. And really, it's about committing to being my own anthropologist, studying myself and my mind and my madness and what I need, and knowing that it's not about finding the best practice. It's kind of about always being curious about new skills, but also knowing that we really are living in a place of, you know, one impermanent moment after the next impermanent moment. And mm-hmm. I'm not the same on any day that I wake mm-hmm. up. It's a new day mm-hmm. and the next hour. So it's kind of like field notes, if I was my own anthropologist, about how do I check in with myself? How do I stay present? And, you know, I have to be really committed. If I want to be part of the world, I have to be really committed to this practice. Sometimes I get angry that other people don't have to be as self-aware as I do. But I realize it's because the consequences for me losing track of where I am or what I'm feeling or what my mind's doing has the potential to cause harm to myself and others. So I'm highly motivated to study myself and to not just study, stay actively connected to what's going on in any given moment with my thoughts, with my emotions.
Yeah. So somebody who knows a lot about different forms of therapy that are out there, mm-hmm. what you're describing is not anything that I have heard come out of a professional's mouth. Where did you learn this? Did you learn it from a professional, or is this something you developed on your own as you kind of went from day to day feeling what you needed and kind of figuring it out?
Yeah, I think I learned different skills or had different insights in different kinds of therapy and different kinds of ways of, you know, learning how to live with trauma, learning about triggers. I had a lot of learning and continue to have that learning. But I think my biggest message about mental illness is that it's different for all of us, and that we have to take agency there and really be able to articulate if we're in relationship to doctors or therapists. I think, you know, for example, if I was to go through a checklist of how well I'm doing, if I was to listen to a doctor's opinion about where my psychosis is, or where my my moods, how intense they are, I probably wouldn't do anything. And so what I had to learn was that for me, psychosis is not an either or thing, right? It's not like the movies where all of a sudden you're in a fractured state and you don't know where you are and you know, think you're someone else. Mm-hmm. There's all kinds of variations between that very extreme form of psychosis and things that I experience every day, which is, you know, I am a voice hearer. So I understand that those voices feel like they come from outside of my head, but I always say they're voices in my head because I know it's my mind generating them. I have bleed through psychosis often in a day where something changes shape in front of me, or I see something that is not really there. And I've learned to be in relationship with that, because if my choice is being superly heavy medicated for none of that to happen, mm-hmm. or learning to be okay with myself and a field note, oh, that's interesting. I'm the trees are really morphing into different things today. And being able to find the language to talk myself through that without panicking, then I get to participate in a wider and wider life. And so I think mad practices for me are like what are the skills and tools that I can pass on, some of which have been picked up, you know, through other teachers and learnings that I've made my own, some of which I've been privileged to, in different cases, had free therapy or therapy that was paid for, you know, by other people, and recognizing that not everybody gets therapy, mm-hmm. And then pass them on as skills for people to try or not try.
Right.
And so I do, I do mad practice workshops and the podcast, and it also just reinforces my learning. It's like when you're writing about something, when you're teaching about something, you have to find a way to articulate it. So it helps me too, to be able to articulate it to myself. Yeah,
absolutely. So much of what we live with is nonverbal. And so when mm-hmm. you talk about doing art, even if you don't know why you're making the trees blue or pink, it doesn't matter, because mm-hmm. you're having a nonverbal conversation with mm-hmm. your own art. And that is, even if we never understand it, it's still a healthy thing to do. In the same way, talking about it, writing about it, all of those things. One of the things you're talking about that strikes me as very important, there are at least two things. One is agency, the power to mm-hmm. or being empowered to take control of what is your mental health or your mental illness, however you want to define it. And the other thing is an acceptance. And I always believe that one of the most healing things that we can do with each other is acceptance. Just accept mm-hmm. somebody for how yeah. they come to you. And I hear that in what you're saying, instead of self-acceptance, that this is who I am and this is what happens in my life, and I'm gonna flow through it and figure it out.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think, and it's hard fought, and it's not a solid state. There are days where I'm very aware that I'm having difficulty in the world, you know, and wish I wasn't. But I think before I might have judged myself about, you know, something I could have done differently. And now I'm learning, like, okay, but this is what's happening right now. And what can I do? You know, the way I think about it is, I think that some things have come farther in the mental health industry. Like, we know that we can make treatment plans, you know, when we're feeling stable again, that are documents that we make with our families or friends, that these are the medications that work best. This is the doctor I like. This is things I do not want to happen. So we have a little more agency for that.
Right.
But we don't really have living plans. You know, I think there's a line in the Play Certified that I use, that psychiatry is good at helping us get through a crisis, but not so good at helping us live after a crisis. And those are the conversations, I think, that happen between mad friends in mad communities that don't always filter into the mental health system. So especially for the newly diagnosed, it's just so much to navigate. And the first thing that has to happen is you have to get, I'm not a big fan of the word stable, but you do have to get some sense of self back, mm-hmm. and that might take a while. And then you can start to think about, you know, how can my life look differently? You know, everything is set up for, you know, typical brain. So it's really unfortunate that if someone wants to carry on with their studies, for example, you know, that student loans make you carry 3 courses, I think. And for people who are in an in-between phase with their mental health, mm-hmm. one would be perfect. Go back, you know, or work part-time. This is just one example. But because you can't do that, those people stop going to school altogether. Mm-hmm. So, you know, this is when we talk about sanism. It's not that that mind isn't of use and couldn't do amazing things. It's that we have all these systematic barriers that are going to keep it up. Oh, you had psychosis and mm-hmm. you had to drop out of university. Well, you have to get well enough, in air quotes on the radio, you have to get well enough to do it the way you used to do it. And that's not going to happen. So then we lose that potential of that human being to take 10 years to get a degree, but to feel connected, to be supported. nothing wrong with that. But in our minds, it's like, if you don't do it this way, then you can't do it at all.
Right. And of course, that is the ableist view of well, this is what normal is, and you're not okay until you can fit this version of normal. And like you said, we really lose out a lot when we're asking people to be what they're not. There's a lot of beautiful things that happen, even when people are in the middle of a crisis, a mental health
That's right.
crisis, you know,
That's right.
and it's so often negated or not seen or not valued. You also talked about in your podcast this notion about coming out, that once we're real, we start to get less mythical and more well-rounded, I think is the words you used. What does that mean? We also talked about romanticizing mental health. I found that interesting. What does that mean to you?
Well, I think, largely that the stories of living with mental illness are still largely told by observers. They're not really told by the people that are living them. And so you see a lot of stories where, I remember the movie Benny and June, and she was super bipolar, manic depressive, and then Johnny Depp comes along and she's okay. She finds love and she's okay, with Johnny Depp. It's just this idea that there's that, that it's bad and then it's okay again. It's not. It's you learn to live with it. There's so many different ways to find a good life, but you it, it's that's not generally the trajectory. You're fucked up, sorry, and you find love and then everything's fine. The other one is that, it's you're very imaginative, and you see that the world, and you have this, childlike thing, which is, I'd say, the line between madness and creativity has always really fascinated people, but I fear that, the faculty that we're losing the most because of the pathology of mental illness is the imagination. That more and more we're afraid, like, to go into our fancy, to really, be weird, to really let our minds go, because what could that mean?
Well, we won't be normal. We
We
won't
won't be
fit that
normal.
mask of normality, and therefore we will be considered incapable, incompetent, and unable, and still sick. So, yeah.
And that idea that if you go too far, you can't get back. And that's another agency thing. So, I write and perform and make lots of collaborative productions, and I've had to learn that my body, I do get kind of high after performing, I do get into these altered states, which are correct altered states to be in. When you perform, you are bigger than your real life self. And I didn't perform for a while. I used to be so scared that that was going to trigger a more mania, because it feels like that in your body. And then it's like, well, that's just euphoria and excitement and performance energy. So once I learned that, I did learn that I need a lot of time to come down after a show, and I know how to do that. But you know what I mean? Like, so that could have scared me off of doing that at all. Or sometimes when I draw or write, some of the things that land on the page are pretty wild. If I'm gonna pathologize that in myself, I'm gonna stop creating.
Absolutely. And it actually kind of breaks my heart that some a whole group of people fear getting excited or being euphoric. I mean, those are gifts that life gives us. And if we are pathologizing that because somebody sees it as a scary thing, then that's kind of sad.
I'll never forget, I was in a day program when I was just coming out of the hospital, and it was called dual diagnosis at the time. I think now it's called concurrent diagnosis, because then you could only have two things wrong with you. And so I was getting help with addictions, and I was at that point labeled bipolar, manic depressive.
Right.
And I remember bringing some of my writing in, and this one mental health worker got very alarmed because it was very tangential.
Mm.
And they saw that as an indicator that I was not stable.
Oh.
And for me, I had just started writing again.
Hmm.
And so for me, I was excited because I was beginning to not be so heavily medicated, and I could feel my creativity coming back.
Right.
So that stopped me writing for another year.
Oh dear. I'm sorry.
And I still write in a way that is not what everyone expects in terms of structure, but these are the things. And if you don't have that dialogue, we talk about the people in the mental health profession, it's still, people are going through these programs like I'm, with a very charitable lens. Like it's like they are in those positions to help us,
right?
And we don't have anything to offer them, right? And
well, except to have them feel good about how well they helped us.
Yeah, exactly. Right. Right. They're giving, they're in a giving profession. And so,
yeah, but I guess what I'm trying to say as well is that it's not fully a giving profession if what they need is to feel like they are the savior.
Mm-hmm.
Then we're just objects at that point too.
Yeah. We're saying, we're saying the same thing. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
So that was an example of, they had a very therapeutic lens on that writing. And you know what, that piece of writing in Certified, I don't know if you remember, but in the play, there's a piece in Certified that is partly that piece I wrote way back then.
Hmm.
Because it was a description of, a poetic description of what happens when things start to go off the rails. But so it's this funny spot. I think they want us to be well or sick. And I think the truth of it is we're between those things.
Always.
And the agency has to come in, like I was saying, the mad practices for me are, like, even after this podcast, I'm going to go for a walk.
Right.
Because I've been connected to you. I'm wide open. I'm feeling all kinds of feelings in my body. I'm going to go and, calm myself down by going for a nice little walk, even though I have all this work waiting. So maybe some other person could just go to that work. But I know if I don't create that break and go and look at some trees, I'll be a little jangly. I won't go crazy, but I'll be jangly, and I won't be as efficient in my work. And if I did that enough days in a row, maybe I would go crazy again. I don't know.
Mm.
But that's mad practice to me, is I know that those things make a difference. I have evidence now that my own treatment plan for living works.
Right. And that's what's most important in this. That's the message. That is most important. We just need to take a little break. JD, we'll be right back.
You're listening to Vancouver Co-op Radio 100.5 CFRO. We are a non-commercial station bringing you voices and stories and perspectives you probably won't hear elsewhere. We are supported by members and by donations. You can become a member by going to our website at www.coopradio.org. If you like what you hear but don't want to be a member, that's cool too. You can still help by clicking on the donate arrow at the top right of the website. Co-op Radio thanks you for listening and for helping build our community of listeners and programmers.
You know I need your love. You got that hold over me. As long as I got your love, you know that I'll never leave. When I wanted you to share my life, I had no doubt in my mind that it's been you, woman, right down.
and they find when you got no one to tell them to, it's true. I was made for you. I climbed across the mountain tops, so I'm out of trouble.
On Vancouver Co-op Radio, CFRO 100.5 FM. I'm Bernadine Fox, and I'm having the pleasure of talking with JD Derbyshire about all things mad. One of the things you talked about, and I know I touched on it in the last segment, about talking about being real and that we need to come out. And it reminds me of encouraging people to come out of the LGBTQ2SA plus closet. And I think that that's really important. I think we hide our mental health issues, whatever they are. I know you've mentioned, let me see if I remember it right, depression, bipolar, manic, psychosis. Did I get them all? Schizophrenia?
Complex PTSD. I don't know. I don't think I've had them all at once, but I've had this wide variety of diagnoses, that's for sure. So yes, I say yes to all those you just said.
Yeah. I had an experience with my child meeting with a psychiatrist for 30 minutes on a Zoom call, from which they decided that he had borderline traits. And I was infuriated. Like, what the, how can you actually say that after 30 minutes? It just seemed to be so unprofessional. Mm-hmm. And I don't think that that's true. I mean, the kid has a lot of different diagnoses, but other things explain the things that they were trying to do that. But there's diagnoses that come with all kinds of shame and fear that if you get that, nobody's ever going to believe you, borderline being one of them. You know, so it I get it. I mean, this whole thing of needing to come out of the closet, we're all a little afraid of it, but it's all really important to do. And I just in that vein, I would like to make sure my audience knows that I live with anxiety and depression. I'm a trauma survivor from childhood, which most of people out there know at this point, I think, but that I also have dissociative identities. And so people assume that if you have that, you're somehow fragile and you can't hold on to life and you can't do things. And in fact, I see it as my superpower, my greatest superpower. If I was an employer employing people, that would be the criteria. Do you have dissociative identities? Right. I will hire you. So, but it's important to say these things and to say them out loud so that people can. In the same way, it was important for people to come out as gay or lesbian, was to for people to recognize, oh, this is somebody who's lesbian. Oh, they're okay. I kind of like them. You know, they're not doing anything weird. And, you know, it changes the landscape for people. And
I think just like coming out, you know, it's important. It's easier for me now because I have the resources I need around me. I have the community I need around me. Mm-hmm. I have a sense of self around me. I can take what sometimes happens. I mean, the great things that happen are often other people come out to you when you same with LGBTQ, et cetera, et cetera. I think we're going to take over the whole alphabet, but
yes.
And I don't mind
as we should.
Adding those letters, keep adding them. I think that, you know, the good thing that happens, I was in a rehearsal of a show that's happening in Vancouver, and I had to leave rehearsal 2 hours earlier because there was just too many people and I couldn't sort as a voice here. I have trouble sometimes in a room with many voices. I have to work really hard to actually kind of filter them through. So I just left 2 hours early and said to the stage manager, I had to leave, take care of myself. And I didn't say anything because, you know, it was around disability art. So I wasn't too worried, but in the morning I had to make a decision. How resourced am I feeling to be vulnerable about this? And I knew going back into the room, one of the things that I needed to do was to not stay sitting at the table. If I sit away from where the other voices are, I have a better chance of sorting them through the things I'm hearing. Mm-hmm. And so I made a decision to come out and just say that little bit. And that was all. I didn't say, you know, what diagnosis. I just said this, and I'm going to be doing this. And, you know, I felt that vulnerability, but I knew it was the right thing to do. And then at the end of that day, one of the people that were working on the production came up to me and said, oh, thank you so much. I just feel like different things are possible. Like I can ask for that. So she was also a voice hearer and working, you know, in the theater, and then recognizing, you know, oh, I could ask for things that, or, you know, she doesn't even need to come out as a voice here necessarily, but to say, I'm going to be sitting away,
right?
Be able to say, right. I'm going to take a break. And so then you start talking about, okay. And I said to her, that's your field note. That's a field note. Now you know that.
Yeah.
And then the encouragement of if you can come out about it or whatever. And then that's how it happens. So coming out is important, but you have to feel resourced and be able to hit the head of vulnerability, because when you come out with mental illness, and it's not unlike when you come out being queer either. Right. Some people are like, awesome. And other people will treat you differently once they know. I mean, that's just a fact. So
it is. And you have to
be resourced, right?
Yeah. Yeah. You have to feel empowered enough that if it's the latter, i.e. they treat you strangely, you're going to be okay with that. So,
you have conversation partners, right? You have community that you can go back into and go, oh, my boss, I did, and it feels weird. And sometimes, like coming out, I remember when I came out to my parents, you know, they were less than thrilled. And a friend of mine at that time said to me, well, how long did it take you to kind of make sense of your sexuality and your gender? Can you give your parents at least that long?
Right.
And that was great. I was
it
like,
is. That's a very good piece of advice. Yes.
And I think that's true with mental illness, because people have to have a chance with all their own biases and, you know, what the media feeds us and what arts and culture feeds us about the myths of madness. So, yeah.
Yeah. And the other reality is that there are some people who, like, I had a guy on who was in an entire art program, and he ended up in hospital. Paranoid schizophrenia, it got out in the school. By the time he came back to school, no one would talk to him. He literally had to leave the school, leave the province, and you know, and those things are sad. They are so unnecessary, but it you know, and I blame popular culture for things like that. I can't tell you how many times a script is fixed by, you know, throwing in a crazed, axe wielding, multiple personality person who just suddenly.
We're either going to, the only thing we're thinking about is how to kill ourselves or others.
Exactly.
That's our lives.
Exactly. It's so, and when we laugh, but it's so sad that is what we're dealing with, is these naive script writers who don't know what they're talking about. So what's on the horizon? What are you up to?
Well, I'm working on a new solo show called Karaoke.
I'm sorry, it's called what?
Karaoke. It's like karaoke.
Oh.
But the audience will get a chance to do comedy routines where instead of the music in the background, it's the laugh track. But I'll also be doing the show inside the show, which is kind of drag kings and queens of famous comedians, and kind of like, I guess the premise of the show is I love stand-up comedy. I don't want us to lose stand-up comedy. I don't want to cancel stand-up comedians, but there's a lot of really bad behavior in stand-up and not enough accountability. So basically I'm going to play comedians that and write apologies for them, apologies I believe they should have made, and in a funny way, and I'm going to teach the audience how to apologize in funny ways, and it's just a really fun show. I love writing stand-up and I love doing comedy, but like I said, I think that we have to be a little more accountable. There's no more gendered space than stand-up comedy. It's very much all men are like this, all women are like this. So I'm going to really play with the gender non-binary and do drag kings and queens and everything in between. So that's in development with the Frank Theater. Really excited about that. That's not going to be till 2024. Then I'm working on a collective creation called As I Die Lying, which is all about the MAID legislation in Canada that, under what reasons would you consider your own life not worth living anymore? And in what way would you consider another person's, circling around mental health? Because so many people think, you know, that my life and everything I have to do to live it makes it not a valuable life. Mm. And that's just not true. So looking at that, that's going to be a collective creation built with a lot of other actors. Mm-hmm. And then I have a book coming out
in
the spring called Mercy Jean, The Man-Made Making of a Mad Woman. And it's a novel, an autofiction novel that's touches on the certified play and experience. But I'm super excited about that. And
Well, when it's out,
novel.
Please
never
come
say
back.
Never.
Please come back when this play comes to Vancouver and when the book is out. Please come back and tell us about it.
Sure will.
Okay. Well, thank you, JD. This has been a very refreshing conversation. I don't get to have these too often with too many people, and it's been a pleasure.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you for all you do.
Oh, that part's the easy part. And we'll be right back, folks.
Eoch, tanuyap. Kuiget Iwans, kuiens na. Hi, everybody. My name is Kuiget Iwans. I'm a member of the Squamish Nation and the Yagalanis clan of the Haida Nation. You're listening to Co-op Radio, CFRO 100.5 FM. We live, work, play. play and broadcast from the traditional, ancestral, and unceded territories of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh Nations.
Do you feel unsafe in your home?
You are not alone.
Transition houses offer free support and shelter for women and children.
We are here for you.
We are here for you.
We are here for you.
Make the call.
1-800-VICTIM-LINK.
1-800-563-0808. BCSCH.ca.
You're listening to Rethreading Madness on Vancouver Co-op Radio, CFRO 100.5 FM. I'm Bernadine Fox, and that's our show. As JD says, coming out is important, but should be done once someone has resources, community, a sense of self, and agency around them so that they are empowered enough to handle it if they find themselves facing discrimination. My thanks to JD for a most delightful conversation, and to Arden, Carlisle, and Ulrich for the gift of their music, but most importantly, and as always, my thanks goes out to you for joining us today. Stay safe out there. You've just listened to Rethreading Madness, where we dare to change how we think about mental health. We air live on Vancouver Co-op Radio, CFRO 100.5 FM, every Tuesday at 5 p.m. or online at co-opradio.org. If you have questions or feedback about this program, or want to share your story, or have something to say to us, we want to hear from you. You can reach us by email, rethreadingmadness@co-opradio.org. This is Bernadine Fox. We'll be back next week. Until then.
When I've never been further, knowing what the hell I'm gonna do. When I can't seem to find my way, under or over or through. Just when I'm ready to give up the fight, there you are when we turn out the lights. And it's alright, it's alright. Just words people say.